Welcome back, folks, to another Jaguar Night obscure historical movie review. And what a treat I'm bringing you tonight. A gem of totalitarian grotesque from the fevered mind of one of the funniest dictators ever to live, Romania's communist tyrant Nicolae Ceausescu. All the heroes of the past were remodeled to distill Ceausescu's virtues, which were imaginary, into them, so that their lives had meaning, mainly to be John the Baptist's of sorts, to herald the coming of our polyvalent genius, our Prince Charming, and filmmakers towed the line. They knew it was good for them. In the final month before his people overthrew him and his Lady Macbeth Elena, who had a head like the north end of a southbound cow, and gave them a 7.62mm Christmas party, the movie Mircea the Older came out. I speak on the 600th anniversary of the real-life Mircea the Older's death, and I invite you to gain a sense of a movie that honours its noble subject, yet makes a mockery of him at the same time. A movie replete with battle scenes so uncommonly good that they gladden my heart. Ladies and gentlemen, Mircea the Elder. We kick off in the splendidly spooky Romanian countryside where belief in supernatural menace comes as naturally as breathing. This opening sequence is sure to give you a sense of deja vu. I believe the director has drunk deep at the well of Excalibur. He had toured the West, so it is possible he had soaked up some new influences there. Like that 1982 movie. Are you feeling it yet? Let's look at Excalibur's opening sequence. There's just no mistaking he's using the same motifs and techniques and themes. And here comes Mircea the Great. Like a boss. Even in that full-faced helmet, you can sense the fear this opponent has for that mighty warlord, Mircea the First of Walachia. Mircea the Elder, or Mircea the Great, played by the legendary director and all-round sportsman, Sergiu Nicolaescu. We gotta see that like a boss entrance again. Yeah, and again, please, I've lived a good life. Oh. The signature feature of this movie, vast, swirling, confused battle scenes, with units feeding themselves into the overall maelstrom as if driven. Seeing already. Just shout Merlin or Uther instead, and the deja vu would be complete. But the epic scale reminds us that it isn't Excalibur. And I dare say here's where he got that boss entrance moment. In the Excalibur progenitor. Now we set up a running theme of this movie, Mircea's regrettable mercy in sparing his treacherous brother Dan, the traitor. It'll be a running theme of this movie, but it is complete fiction. More running themes, the great leader closely resembles the fantasy image which the red tyrant Ceausescu had of himself. Ceausescu by 1989 was a worthy successor to this tradition, and he too was, well, the skies ringed around with traitors like Ceausescu thinks he is. Actually, it was all a flashback, like so much in this confusing movie. This movie makes good use of Romania's natural splendors. It is a beautiful piece of art. See the lad in the bed? We will be seeing a lot of this feisty lad. We see him absorbed in the guilty pleasure of the automaton, cutting-edge medieval high-tech in which two knights joust roughly. He derives so much glee from it because he is none other than the future Vlad the Impaler. Now this one you have heard of. One of the most fascinating rulers who have ever lived, three times warlord of Wallachia, and sadistic killer on an imperial scale. The noise you just heard then was any chance of my positive likes to dislikes ratio continuing. When I had this up on my old channel, many Romanians gave it a dislike and a nasty comment because he is a national hero. He's a national hero because they overlook how incredibly unfair he was actually. Too bad, I'll wear that. I'll choose truth over feelings 100 times out of 100. And the truth is, his contemporaries thought he really was a bit much. And with the printing press recently invented, the bestsellers swamping Europe were broadsheets about Columbus's voyage and this man's atrocities. Here's one of them. One of those broadsheets, a Swiss one. On my YouTube channel, you can see it as an audiobook with benefits. And that's the name right there. Here's another Ceausescu-era film where we see Vlad correctly impaling 20,000 Turks in the one place. But Vlad wasn't even born until 13 years after Mircea died, after this movie's storyline ends. For fuck's sake. This boy should not be in the film at all. And this serves to impale history as deeply as Braveheart or 300 ever did. By this final year of his life, Ceausescu had identified himself so much with the heroes of the past that his fantasies just had to be pandered to. And when watching a product of a Stalinist personality cult, you had better sign on for some plotting, conspiracy, and traitors! Notice how the plotters speak of Sigismund as Emperor of Germany. They should be calling him King of the Hungarians, because he will gain that title many years in the future. This cleric always counsels assassination of Mircea and sell out to German foreigners. Not our good guy in a communist movie, eh? That grandson Vlad the time traveller does the bolt, and there is hell to pay back at the palace. This didn't happen, of course, but it is worth it for the memorable exchange between Mircea and Vlad's mother. You're about to see it. Wow. Well, that no doubt suits the wowserism of the Ceausescu regime, but a Greek source records that Mircea here had many bastard sons, so very likely he had a great liking for tramps, after all. God, she's gorgeous. This helmet suggests we are inspired not just by Excalibur, but by Conan the Barbarian, too. See? Falsar Doom, played by James Earl Jones. I do applaud the massed campfires of an army in the distance. It was like that, historically. And the historically accurate use of squarish shields that come to a point in one corner, thank you. That's the troops marching in the foreground, I stress. Just like you see in this modern artist's impressions, Angus McBride, thank you. I love also the views of courtly life in Targovishta, Mircea's capital, revealed to us through the constant disloyalties of his awful family. Like his son Mihail, Mircea set him up with an unruly horse to test his character. Well, they're not all awful. Like Irina scrubs up well when she's not tramping around undressed. I'm very thankful we get this sequence. More views of the shadowy world of Turgovishta that so delight my soul. Back to that impure family again. We meet Vlad, the future Vlad Dracul. He's in the middle. Where do I start? Perhaps with what the hell are those fungoid growths on his arms, the red things? And these ludicrously overgrown dragon wings on his armor joints. At the elbows, just imagine how much those would complicate sword fighting and horse riding. But most likely the movie gives him these to build him up as the dragon, Dracul, famously a baron of the Order of the Dragon, that's it there. Hard to tell what with so much of this movie being in flashback, but hang on, he didn't get this award until 13 years after the last events in this movie, which is also when that boy there will be born. Yeah, already this movie's all over the place historically. Here's those fungoid growths shown to advantage. Aren't they bloody horrible? Grandson Vlad the Unborn sneaks off to the Turkish encampment, where a typically creepy lord shows off the Islamic world's far superior adult entertainment. Look, since this kid won't be born for about 20 years, no good can possibly come of discussing the kidnap attempt, so bugger it. Let's just join them in enjoying the show. At least until more goddamn traitors rain on our parade. Can't forget it's a communist movie. Still, it's a good argument they have here. The Battle of Ravenna some years back was Mircea's biggie, and yes, both sides claim victory. The Turk is surprised to hear a competing version of it, in which the Romanians won. Dude, why be pedantic? You're still unborn now, remember? You see the battle in flashback. Mircea meets the Turks for the Great Battle of Ravenna, and honestly, this Turkish envoy is wearing cheese graters. The helmet cheek pieces, they're cheese graters. Ravenna will be the epic showdown of the age, although I think the battle you're about to see is just another elaborate flashback. I kid you not, those are cheese graters. If a sword drove that into your cheek, it'd have to hurt. You can't entrust your life to a cheese grater. No, it's one of those things you just never do, as they say. God, I'd love to deliver a line that badass.
No, leather armor was not cheap vinyl stackable chair upholstery like that crap you see in the background there.
I always groan to see Islamic warriors with unimaginative spiky helmets wrapped in turban. It's as grating as that last Turk's helmet. Grating, yeah, pun, get it. But these battle scenes succeed in burying that sin nicely. Accurate Walachian flags, thank you. Then we see the famous pre-battle parley between Mircea and Sultan Bayezid, the Thunderbolt. This is true to life. Battle is joined, and it is huge, just like all the battle scenes in this movie. I say a big no to archers shooting while continuing to run into their own falling arrows. And a big yes to onrushing forces crystallizing into front lines where they meet. Such an antidote to that vault over the shield wall crap infesting movies these days, like you see here in Troy. Yes to the pointy top shields in one corner. Yes to more and more units being fed into the general maelstrom. Yes to Bayezid the Thunderbolt, conqueror of Serbia, being unfazed by high command in a pressure cooker situation. Yes to a swirling general slugfest that you can't keep up with, and just getting buffeted in your own tiny niche of it, or with limited visibility because the slit in your helmet or the eye holes are just claustrophobia inducing. And no to these goddamn instant Muslim helmets I mentioned before. A huge yes to no one trusting a Walachian. They really were reviled for their alleged treacherous nature across half of Europe. That's Dan, Mircea's exiled brother, who he now regrets sparing in that opening sequence. Yeah, that one. Another piece of braveheartery. Sorry, they were two different men named Dan, and this one was loyal. yes, to that conical helmet like we see in the manuscript illustrations. But since this episode here didn't happen, let's call cut for now. Just one moment. Isn't that Randy the Macho Man Savage? Not quite sure. And Mircea's Wallachians have won a bruising victory. The moment of crisis of confidence, Sultan Bayezid gives the dread orders to retreat. A smart medieval warlord cuts an impressive figure, like he would. Now Mircea explains to Vlad the Unconceived that victory was spoiled by the Turks backing his brother down to steal his throne for a while.
But...
No, the traitor was not Dan, who was loyal, but Vlad the usurper. This movie is now wallowing like a junkie in its own fabricated reality. Then the bizarre Crusade of Nicopolis, 1396, passed through his obscure realm. Thousands of Western European knights streamed through in this chaotic adventure. King Sigismundus of Hungary, wrongly called German Emperor here. Too early for that. He gets that title later. Knights from France and Germany, yes, but no, the English did not actually turn up. And there is an inexcusable boner, the modern Greek flag. There it is, which did not exist until 430 years later. They restored Mircea to his throne, and he joined their crusade with large forces. Hold, show some respect. This man was a genuine, fully-fledged badass. He has carried out numerous raids on English cities. He has done much to stop England winning the Hundred Years' War. He has been to war with the terrible Fleming's infantry, and in Spain, too. He even launched a crusade against the Barbary pirate filth, and won it. Please make him look battle-scarred, or just less like a hairdresser or a synthesizer player. The Crusaders were mostly Burgundian and French, and too jealous of their personal status to function as an effective alliance. Not sure Mircea understood what he was getting into. I give a big no to the uniformity of the Crusader foot, just as I did for their Turkish opponents. But this movie captures the enormity of an army and of battles like few others ever have. Nicolaescu, take a bow. You deliver the goods. The Crusader command tent will delight fans of Warcraft 2 and 3, but not fans of history. Good to see some Teutonic Order knights in the foreground. There were some there, and the portrayal of tensions between the nationalities caused by pride and status. Although it was really more heated than shown here. This debate between Burgundians and Byzantines is another fiction, sorry.
Dumneavoastră bizantinii pe care am venit să vă eliberăm, nu prea ne iubiți.
The Byzantine Empire, here represented by despot 70s porno star, was by now the embarrassment of Europe. It cannot project power anymore. The Turks are besieging its capital, and just 6 years ago, they forced the Byzantines to supply troops for the attack on the Byzantine city of Philadelphia. Both he and that gilt-armored Burgundian have armor many years too late to reach 1396. Again, the Byzantines should not be here at all. They are at a very low ebb indeed. I don't like this. They really did discuss letting Mircea start the Allied attack on the Turks, and they did fall out acrimoniously over it. God, that armor's 15th century. Come on.
Își fi de părere să lăsăm să atace primul. Să spargă zidul păgân.
Asistate! Dacă o asemenea insultă mi-ar fi fost adusă de altcineva, n-aș fi avut o clipă de liniște până n-aș fi spălat-o în sânge. Lașule! Ți-e frică să ataci primul?
Eu laș, seniore!
And the ill-starred Battle of Nicopolis begins, correctly on a note of impetuosity and folly. I like that there's rolling hills, correct. It is as praiseworthy as this movie's other battle sequences. I take the liberty of giving you heaps of this battle. There is heaps more besides that I didn't include. To make an escape. Nicopolis 1396 was a classic battle without a morrow. Vlad the Implausible hears about it all in flashback, wondering how Christian Europe wasn't overrun after this disaster. And the reason is that one of those characters that make history fun, Timur Ilink, or Tamerlane, came along and smashed the Ottoman army at the Battle of Ankara 1402, now the capital of Turkey, and took the Sultan live captive. In fact, Timur made war on both of the mighty empires of the region, the Ottoman Turks and Mamluk Egypt, and smashed both of them in one of the most boss things ever done by anyone. And that wasn't all, he also sacked Baghdad, and even a fortress of the Knights of St. John on this super campaign. Nah, fuck it, just sock it to everyone. I'm all right now. And he erected many pyramids of human heads, his signature move. What a man. A big no to that silly pantomime Mongol from the homecoming parade float. Timur's highly organized war machine was a world away from that pirate cosplay crap you just saw there. Like this. This is a realistic representation. Here's some more modern artist impressions of Timur's army. Timur is not too badly portrayed, although he should have richer clothes. But please banish any thought that Bayezid's three sons were captured in the Battle of Ankara with him and told to spit on their father. This is another fraud of the caliber of Braveheart or 300 at their squirming worst. Historians are still mostly dubious about whether Timur really put the captured Turkish Sultan in a cage overlooking his banquet hall, where the Sultan's favourite wife was forced to serve the tables naked, and whether he was used as a footstool and horse mounting block. God, it's a good story though. Hope it's true. Hey, isn't that despot 70s porno star? What's he doing here? How are the mighty fallen? Remember Bayezid like this in his glory days? Well, all this sets up a fireside chat between Vlad the Futuristic and Mircea, in which every word is complete claptrap, thus cheapening any moral instruction it may offer us. What really happened was that Bayezid's sons escaped the great defeat and fought each other back in Europe with bestial ferocity. But the rest of this movie is a depressing trudge through a molasses lake of falsehoods. Like the repeat sniping at Mircea by a crossbow-toting hired killer named Will Stapleton, presumably an Englishman. You will search the history books in vain for any mention of this drivel. Mircea died of natural causes, most unusually for a Walachian ruler, and what we are seeing here is more likely an allegory to Ceausescu's asserted right to be paranoid. Poor old defamed darn yet again. There's Will Stapleton. Should we ponder whether the director was inspired by a standard of proof held by Batman TV series villains, or just dismiss this as another pile of bollocks? We even show our old foe Dan die of a heart attack, as fiction stacks upon fiction.
But!
Though in fact, he lived to be the next ruler.
murit Maria ta. A crăpat inima în el.
Now Vlad the Preposterous gets to play judge at Grandad's behest, no doubt to push the old myth that Vlad Dracula was just, fair and harsh only because he had to be, he was driven to it.
Iertare. Deschidați-mi.
And if you're wondering how Robin Williams really died, I'll show you how. Yes, it was impalement. The things you learn. And we are then treated to the most accurate portrayal of impalement I've yet seen put on the screen. Except for it being ordered by a lad who hasn't been born yet, of course. Before insertion into the anus, the steak was rumpled a bit and oiled, presumably because they practiced safe impalement. Shown young Vlad being a sensitive soul who is rather put out by what he's caused with his verdict. You know, it hurts me a lot more than it hurts you. Can you believe they're still bothering with that crossbow sniper bullshit a third time? This time he succeeds in shooting the right man. But Mircea survives, and even covers it up. Look, this is complete piffle. The Turks are restoring order after the great disaster at the Battle of Ankara. I've carefully edited this scene, because it contains raw tit. And they bring Mircea to a parley again. Yes folks, sorry, I'm keeping it work safe. You see, Romania's great national hero has run out of real options at last, after repulsing four Turkish invasions, and is about to become the first Wallachian ruler to start tribute payments to their overbearing Muslim neighbours. But you wouldn't know it from this movie. He doesn't do it in this movie. He defies them to his last breath. The Turkish envoy pushes his luck, demanding as a hostage young Vlad the anachronism. No. Don't you know that Ceausescu unifies all Romania's historical heroes in his person? And the talks end. Another fabrication. He spots bleeding from the fictitious assassination attempt. Oh dear. Yeah, there he is spotting it. And so in 1418, Mircea goes the way of all flesh. Poignantly, the Turkish ruler admits to having feared Mircea and no other man on earth. From now on, I just want to give you some more tastes of that grand spectacle that is never far away in this great movie, for that it is, despite so many hatchet jobs it does on history. Let's recap those hatchet jobs. Dan, the serial traitor, is a complete slander. Verdict, please. Fake and gay. Young Vlad the Impaler won't actually be born until 13 years after the movie's timeline ends. Verdict. Fake and gay. It is hopelessly confused about just what job Sigismund has had at any time in his complicated career and always gets it wrong. Fake and gay. The Assassin's Creed type hitman only serves to assassinate history itself. Over to you for a verdict, your non-existentness.
Fake
and gay. The movie plays fast and loose with Tamerlane capturing three Turkish princes he didn't capture, yet not the wife he did capture.
Fake
and gay. It has a modern Greek flag, so modern prejudices can be catered to also. Fake and gay. It has the wrong guy take the throne off Mircea and accuses the innocent instead. Fake and gay. It shows the Byzantine Empire punching way above its real weight category for 1396. Fake and gay. Oh dear, it clocked up 8 brave hearts. Yet it has some of the best battle scenes ever filmed, and delivers a fully credible Mircea the Great. The verdict. Impale it last.
Sic semper tyrannis, say I.
And after so long playing Ceausescu's bitch by making movies like this slop for him, he must have been monumentally pissed off by that stage. That's all from the Jaguar Knight. Thank you for watching my video right through to the end. You do me much honour.